Okay, welcome everyone. Welcome to this webinar about SSL and TLS management. I think you already saw that I changed the title from certificate management to SSL management because what we're going to cover today is more related to SSL certificate than it is to all X509 certificates. In the part two of these webinar sessions, we're going to talk more about client certificates and how you can automate the management and the best practices for those certificates as well. So today, we focus mostly on SSL and TLS management. Now, for the people that just joined, if you're still busy with setting your audio settings and everything is not working as it should, don't worry at all. We're recording this session, so we will send the session to everyone who registers for this webinar. So also, as you can see, there is in the webinar function, there is a question and answer, so you can freely type or raise your hand if you have a question. It's difficult for me to have a look at all the questions while I'm presenting, so we have a question and answer session at the end, a short 10-minute session, where I will have a look at all the questions that were raised during the presentation, and I will answer those. Okay? So here we go. So first of all, I'm going to quickly talk a little bit about us, about TrustCube, so you know who we are and why we're having this webinar today. Then we're going into what you came for today, SSL and TLS management, the best practices. We don't want to approach it very commercial. It's going to be a very educational best practices session where you can learn actually how to approach it. If you would do that with us or you would do that with another vendor, these are the best practices that you should have in place. And then, of course, at the end, as I already said, we're going to have a question session. So if you have questions during the presentation, feel free to type them. I will have a look at the end, and then I can answer those questions. Right. So quickly about us, about me, who am I? My name is Johan Bloemen. As of my accent, you can hear I'm actually from Belgium. I'm founder and CEO of TrustCubes. I actually worked at GlobalSign. This is where I got most of my cybersecurity experience. I worked there for 7 years. I have more than 8 years experience in cybersecurity. I also hold some certifications like ISO 27001. I started TrustCubes because I wanted to have actually a wider approach to cybersecurity. And the whole idea about TrustCube is to give a layered approach about cybersecurity solutions. But we don't only focus on PKI solution, but we have a whole layered approach of different solutions, different building blocks or cubes, as we call them, to build your cybersecurity wall, your protection against threats out there. Right. So as you can see here, we have this layered approach to cybersecurity. So today we're going to speak mostly about SSL and TLS management, right? And the best practices. So this is where we started, actually. This is where my background is from. This is PKI. But we also help a lot of our customers in document signing, promote KYC. It's very important that you know with who you're doing business, who is at the other side. Yeah, that's why remote KYC, know your customer solutions are very important. We also work closely with companies and enterprises that want to get their ISO 27001 certifications, that need GRC solutions in place, governance risk and compliance to actually mitigate the risk. And then we mitigate cybersecurity risk. The biggest one actually is the human risk, right? You can have all the solutions and all the technology in place, but if people are still clicking on a phishing link, you still have a breach in your company, right? So that's why it's very important that you have security and awareness training within your company. And we're offering that in different languages as well. So that's quite interesting. So if we look at where we're from, so our headquarters is in the UK, based in Maidstone, very close to London. We have an office registered in Belgium, and I myself, for example, am located in Finland. Now, in blue, we have mentioned some of our partners. We have quite a few partners across the globe, but these partners are actually strategic partners that act like us within the region. So after this webinar, I think there are a lot of people who signed up from these regions, from India, Bangladesh, Malaysia, and Chile. So after the webinar, you will get actually in contact with one of these partners. They have not only the TrustCube's knowledge, but they also have a wide knowledge about local regulations. So in Bangladesh, this is Dhaka Distributions. In Malaysia, this is BitShield. In India, it's ECAPS. And in Chile, it's Security Americas. So those people will assist you, help you with all your requirements around PKI, SSL, TLS management. So in the next slide, you can see a few of our customers. So as you can see, NHS, Cognizant, we have quite a lot of big, large companies that work with us, a lot of energy companies, a lot of government institutions as well. So these are a few of the companies that work with us. Okay, so let's go into it. Let's talk about SSL TLS management, right? And I wanted to start the presentation today with the day the music died. Yeah, I wanted to talk to you about a use case where we can clearly see that because of an expired SSL certificate or a bad managed certificate, one company was in problems, right? And I wanted to give you a recent example. So this is an example from 19 August 2020, so quite recent. And it's about Spotify, right? There was a time that Spotify went offline, and this happened because of an expired certificate. Yeah. Now, there are a lot of organizations that actually had that happening, right? So I'm not picking on Spotify, or I could have also used another company. I'll give you some other examples, right? For example, in 2018, the US government shut down a lot of sites, 11 sites. They went down because of SSL expirations, right? A very important one was when Ericsson let the certificate expire, and this has also had an impact on the O2 network, and 32 million people lost their cellular device. They lost connection, right? There was no 4G connection for all those people, yeah? Another big example is when Equifax missed the breach for almost 70 days because of an expired certificate. They couldn't examine what the root cause was because of an expired certificate. They couldn't actually look at the traffic that was going on that particular server. Yeah, we have some examples where an expired certificate happened at LinkedIn, right? We had even Pokemon Go going down after a certificate expiry. So there are a lot of examples of a lot of big companies that actually had this issue. So what we're going to do today is we don't want to bash these companies. We don't want to say anything negative about these organizations. Imagine your Spotify, you have over 10,000 of certificates to manage, right? But we want to explain what are best practices and how can you avoid this happening. Right. So when something like this happens, where do you see it? The first, you see it actually on Twitter, right? You see a lot of customers complaining, can't load my page, is Spotify down? Yeah. And very soon, a company as Spotify has to give a status. We are aware of the situations. We are checking what is happening. Yeah. And luckily, you have some geeks that immediately help Spotify and actually saw, hey, what actually happened here is, they forgot to renew their TLS certificate. Now, we can talk about what is the damage to a company as Spotify, right, for this happening. Luckily for Spotify, I think they had quite a good remediation in place, and they actually solved the issue within 1 hour. It was 1 hour and 15 minutes or something. They were back online. So they issued a new certificate, and they were back online. So quite fast, but still, if you're Amazon and you have 1 hour of downtime, that costs you a lot of money. Now, for Spotify, did that cost them a lot of money? I don't know. A lot of people are subscription-based for Spotify. So did people went to another provider because they didn't have music for 1 hour? I don't know. It does have some impact, of course, on direct revenue losses. But very important, it has a big damage to your brand reputation. Yeah, there are some compliance issues. You have now people that had to be on spot and had to work on this. Yeah, so you have a lot of resources going now to this particular problem that actually could be better dedicated to helping customers, to attracting new customers, right? You have an increased support time. You have, of course, afterwards an incident report and all the hassle that you have to do after something as this happens, right? So it depends a bit on your organization. I would say that it's very important to have your certificate management on point, and definitely for your public facing certificates, even internal issues, it's very good to have everything with regards to your SSL and TLS management on point. And we're going to explain to you today how you can avoid issues like this. Right. So here are some stats. So there were, okay, so 5,600. These are the cost of what certificate outages cost large corporation on an average per minute, right? 500K, that's for severance outages, which can take days to cost more than 500K per hour, right? That's the estimated cost from a survey from Gartner that it would cost to actually solve these outages. And the average cost of data breach in 2019 was 3.76 million. Yeah, so these are all stats coming from Gartner. In a survey as well, they asked IT leaders and CIO if they are concerned, and 50% say they are very concerned about certificate outages because it will impact their customer experience, and 40% of the IT leaders were very concerned by all the resources that are lost actually, and that would have been better spent on customer facing tasks if they would not have these outages, right? So now I'm going to go into 10 tips, 10 best practices that you should have in place. And these will help you, if you have those 10 in place, will help you for your complete certificate management policy and will avoid you of having these type of outages or having certificates expiring or having actually wikis. Yeah, so this will make sure that you can control it. So it's quite important. It doesn't matter if you're going to work together with us as a vendor or with someone else. These are 10 educational points that everyone should have in place, and then you would avoid actually downtime. You would avoid that your certificates will be expired, right? If you have these 10 items in place, it normally cannot happen, right? So first of all, and as you see in the ISO 27001 standards, you need to have a policy, right? You need to understand who is doing what, who is authorized to do what, yeah? And as always, the fewer cooks in the kitchen, the better it is, yeah? Make it simple, the KISS principle, keep it cooked, stupid simple. Things you definitely need to cover, right? You need to cover how you're going to and where you're going to use your digital certificates in your organization. Yeah, you need to identify who are the individuals involved in certificate management and what role do they have, yeah, and what permissions will you give them. Yeah, you need to have a primary CA and you need to have a backup CA, right? And we'll go more into that actually in part two of our discussion, where we really are going to talk about mitigating a single CA risk. That's more in the part two of the webinars. I'll also give you an example. It's you can think it's very rare that a certificate authority will have a breach or something will go wrong, but actually it happened a few times. So in the next webinar, which is 2 weeks from now, we'll give you some examples where CAs made mistakes, and it would have been good that you had a second CA in place, right? Okay, you need to check which certificates are you going to use and for which use case. Is this an internal domain? Are you okay with a private certificate or needs to be a public certificate because it's a public-facing website? And what validation level are you going to give for public-facing websites? Is your standard always EV level? Is it OV level? These are things you need to write down in your certificate management policy. And then certificate coverage, a very popular thing to use are wildcards, but they actually also give a risk. It's very popular because they're you pay one time for actually to have a star.domain.com. Yeah. And anything what can be in that star, login.secure. Yeah. Will be protected by that certificate. However, it's also very much a risk because you don't know often which domain names are covered under this. So we would always recommend to use actually single name certificates to minimize that risk. Yeah. Okay, then very important, what you need to do is you need to centralize certificate management. And this is where we have a tool that will come in handy, but this is definitely something you need to do, right? You need to have a central tool where you can issue OV and EV certificate to pre-validate a domain. What does that mean? The CA will already validate your domain. So if something happens and you need a certificate urgently, right, you can issue it straight away on OV and EV level. Yeah. If you wouldn't have this in place, then you need to go to the CA, wait for validation, yeah, where they will check company house, they will give you a phone call to check if you really are who you claim to be and that you're aware that you're going to order the certificate. And this takes time. This can take up to 1 week to 2 weeks. So if you use a centralized managed PKI system from a certificate authority, then these domains are pre-validated, these organizations are pre-validated, and you can issue a certificate instantly. Yeah. What you also need is a What you also need is a certificate discovery tool. Yeah, and we'll talk in the next point a little bit more about that, where we are going to say about how you scan your network and what you have to look for. Right. This tool needs to be available 24/7. Right. It can, your breach can happen anytime. Your outage can happen anytime. It can be on a Sunday evening. Right. So you need this tool to be available 24/7. You need some good user access management tools. We'll talk a little bit later about setting roles and privileges for certain people. And this is something the tool should support, right? You need to make sure that this tool can actually say this user can request a certificate but can't issue it, right? And this is the admin. He can issue a certificate or he can approve certificate requests from his IT employees, right? ACME integration, that's a very interesting and a very important one. This is going to allow you to automate. And this is very important, definitely with the certificate's length that is going to become shorter and shorter, that you can actually automate your renewal process. But not only the renewal process, but also the automatic enrollment and the automatic installment on the server. Yeah. And that's where a lot of mistakes are still made. This is where a lot of time is lost as well. So it's quite important that you can automate this. Yeah. And then a finance management and reporting task. These certificates, the public one, are costing money. And it's a shame that if you have everything automated in place, but then the financing and the reporting is out of date and you probably cannot order because your financing, you don't have enough funds in your account or your agreement with the CA is as such that you still have outstanding bills and they don't issue you a certificate, right? So that's why it's quite important to also have a clear finance management and reporting system so that you're always on top of your funds and that you can know for sure that you can issue certificates without any issue that even the financial part is covered as well. Okay, so point three is scan your network. So this is a very important one. And this is actually a tool that not everyone has integrated in their managed PKI. Actually, most don't have it integrated. But a lot of companies purchase it somewhere else, purchase it separately, because this is very key to have, right? So what you need to do is you need to at least scan your network once a week, yeah? And this is because you can say, okay, I scanned my network in the beginning and I have a policy, but people still make mistakes and people still might, a new IT member still might not know the policy and he might have issued a self-signed certificate, yeah, with a weak key length. So it's very important that you keep on top of that and that you scan at least once a week. You can scan even once a day. So you always have an accurate situation about what certificates are in your network, right? Monitor the certificate transparency logs, yeah, for your domains. So this is an initiative by Google where you have certificate transparency and you can see actually all certificates for the public domains. Here you can also see if people are trying to create a website with a URL very close to your ones, a sort of phishing site where they are trying to get a certificate on, right? So this is quite important that you log these certificate transparency logs. Yeah. When you find a shadow certificate is actually a certificate that is ordered without your policies, then you have to talk to the requester and you have to educate them about the procedures and say, hey, we're in this organization, we have a certificate management policy and we don't issue self-signed certificates, or we do issue self-signed certificate, but they have to be at least these standards, right? Or they have to follow this approval flow before you can issue those certificates. Okay, and then very important, what a tool like this will do as well, not all of them, but the one that we have does it. It also scans for vulnerability, right? And this is very important that you see, actually, are you following the latest standards? Yeah, for example, things you have to look out for is SHA-1, MD5. Yeah, MD5 is an algorithm that has been hacked, so it is not in use anymore. But if you're using self-signed certificate, you can easily issue yourself a certificate of MD5. Yeah, we all moved from 1024-bit to 2048 key length. Yeah, again, for more security reasons, we have a bigger key length as computers get smarter and smarter. So it's very important that everyone is using the best standards and the best vulnerabilities. What you also will see, you will also see in this platform some server issues where you might have to watch out for, or if you're using a software like OpenSSL and if that's still on the newest version, because I don't know if people know about the Heartbleed incident, but this was an older version of OpenSSL that actually had a leak, where a lot of customers got impacted, actually, because they didn't have the last version of OpenSSL on their machines. Yeah, so these are things which are very important, that you scan your network regularly and that you mitigate these risks, that you make sure that all your certificates are properly installed and that there are no vulnerabilities within your organization, within your network. Okay, then set permissions, right? Assign permissions for users. Yeah, approve, revoke, and give them only the permissions they need. So in an organization, not every IT person should have the ability to actually issue certificates. It's best to keep this central with just a few persons, and also persons that actually know about keys and actually have this experience, right? Always follow your certificate management policy, and also write down in your certificate management policy what these permissions are. Yeah. And assign per user, per role department. Yeah. And last but not least, make sure that you have an audit trail within your system, because if something happens, then at least you can go back, you can file this to your compliance, and you can see what user did what, right? And you can see what happened exactly. Okay, approval and escalation flow. Okay, it's you have an approval flow and you probably have an administrator that will approve the certificates request, someone that is knowledgeable about PKI, but make sure that that person is available. And if that person is not available, make sure that there is an escalation path in place, right? So if a person is absent or on leave, make sure you have at least two employees that are on an administration level and that can approve these type of requests and are actually aware of everything that is going on, right? And mistakes are human, so make sure that there is an escalation path in place. If someone didn't do their task within 1 hour, 1 day, 1 week, yeah, depending how urgent the actual task is, yeah. At Spotify, when everything broke down and people couldn't listen to music, then it was very important that the person that was aware of this was there, and or other persons were there, and they could actually fix it within a few minutes, right? So it's quite important. Issue certificates from a fully managed PKI. Okay, so we would recommend definitely for people who don't have the PKI knowledge, the in-depth knowledge, to use a public CA. Yeah, always use a public CA. Public CA will use the best practices. They have to follow the CAP forum guidelines, so they will use the right key lengths. Yeah, so this is your safest way. They will have a certificate policy. They will have CRLs, right? Certificate revocation list and OCSP responders to make sure that everything is fully managed. They are audited to do that, so it. It's very important that you use one of those. If you still want to set up your own managed private CA and you have a team and you have the knowledge to do so, then please do so, but make sure that it includes the complete fully managed PKI, which means you need to have a certificate logging, you need to have a CRL, you need to have an issuance policy, you need to make sure that there is an issuance auditing, and you do some vulnerability scanning and testing. So make sure that you have those items in place if you use a managed private CA and you're going to do it yourself. Yeah. Streamline validation. Yeah, I think we already talked about this briefly when we were talking about OV and EV level certificates. So as you know, domain validated certificates are easy actually for even a phishing site to get a domain valid certificate. Yeah. Some CAs have some phishing filters, but free CAs like Les Encrypt don't even have phishing filters. And if you have a domain and you can prove ownership of that domain, you can order a domain validated certificate. So it's best to give some extra trust to your customers, definitely for your public facing websites, and to use OV and EV SSL certificates. Yeah. Now, these certificates can take a while to renew because you have to go through validation. So that's why it's very important that you have a certificate management, managed PKI system in place that you can pre-validate at the CA to make sure that you have actually an instant issuance. Yeah, and to be really safe, what you can do is you can actually pre-validate your domains and your organization at two CAs. So if something happened at a certificate authority, you can easily switch it over to the other one. Yeah. Now, the industry standards, as you know, is shortening the validation length of certificates. So in the past, you could have certificates up to 5 years, then it became 2 years. And now, as of 2 months ago, it's 1 year certificates. And this is a trend that we will see continuing. We will see actually going forward certificate that might be only valid for the session. Yeah. And this is very good from a security standpoint, because the longer actually the certificate is valid, the longer that it is valid, the longer time a hacker would have to actually hack and break the code. Yeah. So the shorter the validity is, the less time this hacker has to actually use his supercomputers to hack the key, right? And the encryption algorithm. So this is security-wise very good, but of course it is another hassle, it is another burden, and that's why automation is very important, right? So enable automation, right? What you can do is, and what is causing mostly the delay in getting certificates is actually, first you need to generate the keys, you should submit that CSR to the CA, then you need to wait for that certificate to be issued to you. This is assuming you have pre-validated organization and domain setup already. And then you need to install the certificates, right? So it's quite a manual task where things can go wrong. So a very good protocol is the ACME protocol, which will allow you to automatically enroll and install these certificates. So the ACME protocol will actually generate that CSR, send it to the CA via API, will get the certificate back, yeah, and will install it on the server. And this is all automated, right? And you don't have to do anything yourself. So this is a very good automation to have enabled, right? And then next week, we can talk a little bit more. So ACME is for SSL, but we can talk a little bit more about other key management tools and Active Directory integrations. So you can issue certificates, also client certificates on your endpoints. Basically, it works a bit the same as the ACME protocol. It's always a client that is installed in your endpoint that actually will do the request of the certificate by submitting a CSR, waiting for the certificate, and installing it, right? But it's very key, definitely with the shorter length of certificate validity that you're going to enable automation. Okay, automate renewals and notifications, right? So a lot of these certificates were actually because it was an expired certificate, yeah? And a certificate has an expired ring date. So make sure that actually you automate the renewals, yeah? It's very good to have notifications in place and do it manual, but we would always promote to actually automate the complete renewal, yeah? And then, for example, what you can do is you need to make sure that more than one party is... So as you can see in the print screen below, make sure that this goes to an email group or make sure that at least more than one person is actually getting these renewal notifications. Yeah. And then a nice thing what you can do is you can set a fallback renewal notice. So if your certificate management policy is saying I renew every 30 days before expirations, then you should set another notification for 15 days, right? And you can have the ACME protocol and that can renew automatically 30 days before. But if you see a notification in your mailbox saying this certificate has 15 days to expire, then you know something went wrong, right? With your automation, something went wrong. And then you still have 2 weeks to actually fix the problem. Yeah, so it's quite important that you set this safe failback procedure in place so you know what is going on. Yeah, and even though you automated it, it is very good to have these notifications so you are aware what is actually going on, right? And then the last bond is generate and review reports, right? So a platform like this will generate reports where you can track your expiring certificates, where you can see all the pending requests that you have. You can see upcoming expirations, right? You have a summarized data always available about all active certificates, revoked certificates. You do a scan regularly so you can see if there are vulnerabilities, if there are people that actually issued a self-signed certificate when they were not allowed to, or issued the certificate from another CA, so you can keep track of that, right? So always see if there are certificates that are new that you discover and look out for vulnerabilities. Yeah, look out for these vulnerability if they still have a weak key like MD5, SHA-1, a weaker algorithm, and so on. Okay. So these are the 10 points. What we will do is we will share those 10 points with you. We actually have a guide which you can download on the website, which is actually talking about 14 points, which are actually the same as I mentioned today. It's just some of these points I actually took together in one point, for example, renewal and notifications. Yeah, in that guide, these are two separate points. But have a look at that guide if you want more information. We'll also send you the webinar so you can always review and can make sure that you have these items in place. So what is very important is that you actually have a certificate management platform in place. And this today it was an educational best practices webinar. So we're not going into details about what our certificate management platform does and how we actually address all those 10 points within one software tool. Yeah. But if you want to have a demo, then you can contact your partner, the TrustCubes partner, or you can contact TrustCubes directly, and we're happy to give you a demo how that solution would work. Now, this solution is completely for free. So if you want, you can just sign up for this solution, and you can start actually already with scanning and seeing actually what certificates you have in your network, if there are any vulnerabilities. Yeah, so a lot of organizations ask money for this only scanning tool, right? With us, it's for free, so you can use that system, you can already scan, and you can see actually what is going on in your organization. Now, as it is for free, you probably wonder where we make money. Well, in that system, after you've done the scanning, you can easily renew certificates. Yeah, and within that system, you can work with revalidated organizations and you can issue certificates. Yeah, these are TrustCube certificates issued by your ICA with DigiCert as top group CA. Yeah, so for actually the CA trust hierarchy. Yeah, So these are certificates we issue, and that's where you pay, basically. So you pay for the certificates. But if you want pricing on that, you can talk to your partner or you can talk to your TrustCube's representative, and he can explain you actually what the pricing would be for the certificates. So the tool, the complete management tool, is completely for free. You can then choose to actually do it all manual, or you can use the best practices and actually automate everything within that tool and issue certificates from TrustCubes. Okay, so we're here at the last slide already. Before I'm going to answer some questions, I'm going to see if there are some questions from the audience. I wanted to let you know that we'll have a second webinar, which is a part two, which is a little bit more technical, more in depth about what we did today. Today was mainly focused about TLS, SSL, yeah, and how you could use a platform where you can actually mitigate the complete risk by following these 10 best practices. Yeah. In the next webinar, 2 weeks from now, we will talk about how you can mitigate this single CA vendor risk, yeah, and how you can have a platform maybe in place where you can actually issue certificates from multiple CAs, or where you can easily switch from one CA to another within a second, right? We will also talk how you can further automate enrollment and installment. So we talked today about the ACME protocol, which is very good for SSL, but we will also talk about client certificates that you can use for authentication or S/MIME, and how you can actually automate the enrollment and installment of those certificates. We'll also have a short demo about how you can manage and control keys, yeah, within that system. There is also availability in that system to have a private PKI. So remember when we talked about public and private certificates, I recommended you to go with a public CA. But if you want a private CA, we just outsource and managed by us, basically, that's available as well. And we will talk a little bit more about that in that webinar. And we'll give you a very short overview of that key and certificate manager platform, yeah, that we use to actually completely automate all X509 certificates, right? And not only SSL. So today, mainly focused on SSL. I hope you find it interesting. So we would love to hear from you. I'll have a look now if there were any questions, and I'll answer those. Okay, I stopped sharing my screen. Okay, so one question is, can I manage my Sectigo certificates within the Cert Central tool? So, yes, you can. So what you will see is when you use a scanning tool, you will see all your certificates available across CAs. You will see your Microsoft CA, your self-signed certificates, you will see your Sectigo, Global Sign, you will see all certificates within that tool. Yeah. However, if you then want to renew that certificate, yeah, and you click the renew button, it will be renewed with a TrustCube certificate, right? So if you just want to use a management tool and you really want to have your Sectigo certificates, then what you should do is you have, again, a very manual work, right? Because you see that there is actually a certificate that needs to be renewed within your Cert Central. You then go to your Sectigo platform and try to renew it there. So again, quite manual. So we would always advise you to actually use a system where it's intended to be, and just renew your certificate with the TrustCube certificates within the system. I hope that answered the question. Okay, what details is required for scanning the network? So you need to configure your scanning tool. So public facing certificates is something that works with certificate transparency, and you actually don't need to open any ports or do anything special. You can just start scanning for public certificates straight away. But if you want to also scan your internal network, you have to actually add within the tool an IP range. Yeah, and within that IP range, actually, this scanner will scan. Yeah. So what I can do is, for the people who ask this and for other people that are interested, we have actually a short video about how to actually enable the scanning tool, yes, which will show you exactly how you do this, yeah, how you set up the scanning for internal network. Yeah, so I'll share that with you after this setting. Okay, another question here: is the Cert Central certificate tool unique to TrustCube? In other words, is it not offered by other CAs? So actually, the Cert Central tool is actually a tool that is created by DigiCert. So when we set up our CA and when we set up TrustCube CA, we actually looked at what are the best certificate management platforms there and should we develop our own. So when we looked at that, we actually saw that DigiCert has the best platform out there, which does the whole life cycle. Yeah, if you look at other CA, they from the 10 points I mentioned, they might have 5 points. Yeah, most of the CAs don't have the built-in scanning tool. Most of the CAs don't have the ACME protocol, which allows automation. So that's when we talked to DigiCert and we said, hey, can we actually have our TrustCube CA within that platform? And can we purchase that license from you? Because this is a very good tool. So Cert Central is not unique to only TrustCubes. DigiCert has it as well. A lot of the DigiCert partners don't offer it. They mostly use the DigiCert APIs and they just order certificates via APIs and they don't have this complete tool in place, right? DigiCert doesn't also allow all the partners to just resell that solution because that's their unique management solution. Okay, Cognizant was in the news due to compromised service. It would be nice if you could share the details. I have to look at that article when they were in the news to compromise service. We do work with Cognizant. We supply certificates to them. Now, Cognizant is quite a big organization. We mostly supply certificates to them in India and the UK. I don't know which servers were compromised, or I didn't see that news item. So I'll have to look into that, and then I'll can provide you more of an insight what actually happened, if it was at Cognizant or if it was at one of his customers, if it had something to do with SSL, yes or not. Okay, then another question is, can I know what the difference is between cloud and on-premise? Okay, so you can set up your PKI infrastructure in the cloud, or you can set that up on-premise, on-site. Now, we mostly recommend to go with a public CA, which would mean that the actual CA that is issuing the certificate is somewhere in the cloud, right? You can do that for private CAs as well on-premise. Yeah, you can set up your whole PKI infrastructure and you need to make sure that you have your certificate revocation list. You need to have to make sure you have your certificate policy, your CPS, your certificate pregnant statements. And then you can do that completely on-premise as well. You can do that, for example, with Microsoft CA. The only catch, of course, with on-premise is that you don't have the public trust. So this is mostly used for maybe internal connections or devices that are not connected publicly, right? Or not publicly facing websites. Yeah. So this is the main difference to actually having your CA in the cloud or on premise. Yeah. But almost every organization will have actually this actual CA in the cloud. Yeah. The only thing that travels is actually the hash, right? If there are concerns for data policies, or I know that a lot of organizations and a lot of banks these days are moving back that they need to have everything on-premise for security reasons. But even big banks, they all work with the actual CA in the cloud, but they might have a certificate management system completely on-premise. Yeah. The tool that we're going to explain actually in our next webinar, 2 weeks from now, that's a solution that you can deploy on-premise if you want. It's a certificate and key management platform. The tool we talked about today, Search Central, that's something that's only available in the cloud. Okay, so these were all the questions. Something is coming in now as well. Okay, so you have the question about free SSL licenses, right? And the difference, what is the difference between a free SSL and a paid SSL? So the free SSLs are issued from an organization called Let's Encrypt. Yeah, and these are domain validated SSLs. Yeah, so the best practices is actually to use an organization and or an extended validation SSL. Now, the difference is for an organization or an extended SSL, there needs to be a validation that needs to happen. So besides actually only checking, do you control that domain? They also check, who are you as an organization? Yeah. So what the CA will do is they will go to company house and they will check, is this organization really an organization that exists? And then they will look for a publicly registered number. They will contact the organization. They will say, someone is requesting a certificate on your behalf. Do you approve? And can you verify that this person is working for your organization? And then they will issue that certificate to you. So it's actually a validation of your organization. What they will do is they will embed that validation and that organization details in the certificate. Yeah. And you have this form of authentication, right? So if you go to an OV or an EV certificate, you can now see, actually, I'm going to trustcubes.com and I know that this site is being managed by an organization called Trustcubes Limited. So you feel much more secure to actually buy from that organization. If it's just a DV domain validated, I can easily buy a domain now, yeah, which is bangladeshbank.com, right? And if I buy that domain, I can get a certificate on it, right? Because I can prove that I have control over that domain. I can set up my email addresses, the admin@domain.com, and I can prove I have a domain. So this is often used for phishing websites. So if you want to make sure that you show the trust to your clients, then it's much, much better to actually use a paid certificate, an OV or an EV certificate. I hope that explained it. Is the free license being protected? Yeah, so the difference is actually the authentication. So you don't know who is behind that website. Yeah, while with an OV and EV, you know that the CA validated who is behind that website. That's the only difference. The encryption will still happen the same, right? Your communication with a free SSL certificate will also be encrypted. Oh, yeah. Okay. So I think that was it. I want to thank you all for attending this webinar. We will send the recorded version of this webinar to you and to everyone who registered. I think actually most of the people that registered attended, so that's quite impressive. A lot of people on the call today. And we will definitely follow up with you. So if you have questions, please reach out to your partner responsible for your region or reach out to us directly. We can bring you in contact with that partner or we can help you directly as well. And we can make sure that we can actually help you to get the best practices for SSL management in place. And if you are also using client certificates and want to know how to manage those and want to know a little bit more in depth about how to mitigate a single CA vendor risk, then I invite you to the next webinar, which is going to be 2 weeks from now, which I'll present as well. So thank you very much. I hope everything was very clear and I'm looking forward to hear your feedback and I'm looking forward to connect with you offline after this webinar. Thank you so much.